What is consciousness? And how can we better understand what our brains are actually doing when they are experiencing consciousness?
It's one of those early stages of scientific development in which we are still agreeing on the concepts.
Historically, consciousness has been studied by comparison to unconscious states like dreamless sleep, but some researchers are interested in another perspective.
We try to understand how do we change the quality of conscious experience in a radically different way.
One way to alter consciousness is through the use of psychedelic drugs. These are compounds that can change a person's experience of consciousness.
Vast vistas, infinite expanses of detail and intensity.
And studying the effects these chemicals have on the brain might be key, not just to unlocking our understanding of how consciousness works, but also to treating some of the problems that can affect our waking lives.
What's intriguing is that it appears that there's a wide plethora of possibilities of applications. And that's why we think that psychedelics may be acting at some form of core mechanism. We think of consciousness simply as experience, right? So that remains when we are not in dreamless sleep or under anesthesia. We think that consciousness, in terms of human experience, needs to contemplate also the alteration of consciousness while we are still experiencing something.
Chris Timmerman's research uses psychedelic substances to disrupt some of the key aspects of the human mind, like throwing a stone into a still pond to see what happens.
Perception makes up our day-to-day experience of reality. In the psychedelic state, the features of perception, our features of what constitute the external world, are modified. So, for example, with this experiment that we do with DMT, we see that people have a perception of entering, if you will, alternate dimensions that feel very real. All right, so subjectively felt to people as very strong. Modern neuroscientific theories posit that somehow we live in some form of constrained hallucination. We make up reality. So, intriguingly enough, in the psychedelic state, we may be able to access some of the brain mechanisms that allow us to construct realities, even our ordinary reality.
To perturb people's perceptions, as well as other elements of consciousness in the brain, Chris needed a suitable drug. His current focus is DMT, or N,N-dimethyltryptamine, a naturally occurring compound found in small amounts in many plants. DMT is one of the active ingredients in ayahuasca, the brew that has been prepared by indigenous peoples in the Amazon basin for social and religious uses for over 1,000 years. When it comes to research, DMT has several advantages over other psychedelics.
With DMT, we have a very reliable way to induce a transformation of experience in which external reality is radically transformed. What feels like a real new sense of reality comes up, emerges, that feels very immersive. And the duration, so this entry into the state lasts only 10 minutes. So here we have an opportunity to have someone in the scanner, for example, administer DMT and capture their brain activity throughout the whole process.
The next challenge was finding participants willing to undergo this intense experience under observation.
I've been a long-term meditator for 30 years, and so I'm very interested in the nature of consciousness and the nature of self. And I started to hear about some of the research that was being done in psychedelics, and there was this whole renaissance in the last 10, 15 years. I was sort of drawn to try it. And even though I'm over 50, I thought, well, you know, this is actually a good time to try it.
Shamil was so interested in the new research into psychedelic medicine that he helped set up the Centre for Psychedelic Research at Imperial College London. which is how he learned about Chris's work.
As I became involved in the center, I knew that Chris was working on this DMT study, and I thought it was very interesting.
Having been judged a suitable trial candidate, Shamil was eventually prepared to receive a dose of DMT while having his brain scanned.
And I was definitely nervous by that stage.
We're scanning the person before the drug is injected. We scan them during the injection. We scan them throughout the whole experience. And also when they're back, participants describe a range of different phenomena.
I get this incredible energy, vibrations going throughout the body. And in the visual field, I feel the entire visual field pixelate into fractals, into geometrical patterns. The body kind of dissolves in this enormous rush of energy. You go up into realms. Very difficult to describe. Super high definition, moving patterns and geometry.
After that, we perform interviews, questionnaires, we capture psychological data, or what we call phenomenological data that pertains to the study of human experience, so that then we can interpret whatever change or modification we see in brain activity in light of experience. The intriguing thing is that this experience many times for the individuals feel very authentic, very real. It's almost as if an experience that they never thought their mind would be able to conjure up.
But what do these experiences tell us about how the brain actually processes consciousness?
We know that different brain oscillations govern brain functioning, right? And different brain waves are related to different states of consciousness.
The electrical activity of our brains can be measured to reveal neural oscillations, the different patterns that emerge as networks of synapses communicate with each other. These brain waves change depending on what our brain is doing. For instance, low-frequency delta waves come to the fore when we sleep, while gamma waves become more pronounced when we're concentrating. Alpha waves normally emerge when we have our eyes closed and dampen down when we open them. But DMT changes this.
The DMT comes in and this alpha wave goes down, but the eyes are still closed. But nonetheless, they're having a very vivid experience at the sensory level. And then the other one is that we see that the lower frequencies, lower oscillations, when it comes to brainwave activity, such as delta waves, which are also very pronounced in states of sleeping, we see that also they become elevated. And when you think a bit about what is really occurring in dreams and in sleeping, is very similar. We are detached from this external world, but nonetheless, we start playing these movies in our brains, in our minds, making up convincing reality, convincing experiences, very much as what happens in dreams.
And to further understand the effects of DMT, Chris is using fMRI, a technique better at pinpointing what is happening in specific locations and specific networks within the brain.
I think we can understand these findings in light of the notion that consciousness is this form of constrained hallucination, and that this form of constrained hallucination is governed by the hierarchy of these brain systems, how they are arranged, and more importantly also what is happening at the top of this hierarchy. The systems that govern all the rest of the connectivity patterns all the way down when it comes to human experience, all the way down even into our more basic perceptual levels, right? So the idea is that models govern our perception of what is real and what is not real. Apparently with psychedelics, when you disrupt these models at this very high level, everything down also can be altered in a very significant way. The brain is able now to explore new models, new stories, new possibilities that can have the level of immersion and reality that our everyday lives also have.
Understanding how these drugs act on the brain and the effects they cause to the systems that underpin our consciousness opens the door to some exciting practical applications.
Well, when you think about depression or anxiety, one of the stable features is the symptom of rumination, right, in which bad stories are replayed, and we cannot really break away from them, right? There's kind of like a looping aspect to them. If psychedelics effectively enable the system to more flexibly adapt into different models that may be more healthy, then we could expect that these substances have strong uses when it comes to depression and anxiety, for example, or things that have rumination, or other conditions in which the idea of maladaptive models are present.
DMT shows incredible potential, both as a clinical treatment and a tool for research. And next, Chris wants to better harness the drug, customizing and extending its effects to reap even greater rewards.
When we think about personalized medicine and we think that every individual have their own needs, for example, we can now think of tailoring that experience to that individual for a specific mental health purpose. And from the point of view of consciousness research, it provides us also a flexible way to explore the ways in which we induce the alterations of experience and therefore try to address some of these fundamental questions that concern human experience.